Welcome, friends, to this post-lunch session. I hope you all enjoyed the Middle Eastern lunch.
It was very good.
I'm very happy that Fatan and Samer and other family members have organized this meeting and provided the lunch. And I want, on behalf of all of you, and you join me in thanking them for that. In the morning, I was suggesting to you that there is a way to discover that this body of yours is not only yourself, there is more in it. And I suggested a little exercise that you can use by starting with imagination. Place yourself behind the eyes at the third eye center, in the center of your head, imagining this body is a house, you are on the sixth floor, do your activities there, you will find your inner self. The inner self, discovery of the inner self, and ability with practice to go anytime by withdrawal of attention, a physical move that you are leaving your awareness of the body and going there, helps in many ways. One is that you yourself discover that when you die, this body dies, not your real self. The fear of death goes away. We just wearing this body temporarily. Secondly, you also find out that all our relationships here are temporary. Because when you find that you go within that to a life that you led before, life that you will lead afterwards, these relationships were created very temporary. They are not going to last forever. And most importantly, you find that the properties you are acquiring, this is my car, this is my house, these are my things, I am buying new dresses, I am buying this thing, none of them will go with us at all. None of them are useful with the inner self. And the inner self will survive and this will not. So a whole change of attitude takes place by this exercise, which is very useful. People try to practice detachment from these things. So long as you are taking them as real, you cannot be detached. In fact, trying to practice detachment creates more attachment. If you try to say, I don't like this, I don't want this, I don't want this, you will remember that all the time. I came to the United States and there used to be ye old Shakey's pizza. I love that pizza. It's something new for me. And I then thought I am getting attached to it. So one day I said, I am going to say to myself, no more Shakey's pizza. The more I said, the more pizza came in front of me. So detachment cannot be practiced. But later on, a Pizza Hut opened up and I forgot Shakey's. The only way to have actual detachment is to be attached to something else. Attachment can create detachment, but not a practice of detachment by itself. So when you discover that the reality of your experience, which lasts longer than this body, is different, that the people who are there with you are different than the ones you are seeing here, your attachment develops with those who are with you longer and not with those who are temporarily, and a detachment comes. A very big change. Detachment to your properties and things you are trying to make your own is a very important thing. If we understand how life begins, you can also understand that from the nature of the other body, which carries within the same mind, carrying the same impressions, carrying what we call the same karma. The law of karma is operating with our minds. And since the other bodies also contain the same mind, karma continues so long as the mind is alive. This body of ours has a very limited age. Average is considered to be 100, 90, 80, 100, 120. People don't live very long on this body. Inner body lasts 1,000, 2,000 years, 3,000 years of physical time. The mind lasts for millions of years. So the karma that we carry on the mind lasts for millions of years. So the same thing, same impressions we are carrying from lifetime to lifetime determine our life for the next time. And when we look at what brings us back to this same physical life, is attachment. You'll find we are attached to people, attached to things, and they bring us back. There was a friend of mine. He wanted very much to come and listen to my talks, which I was giving at different places. But he wrote to me once, "I am sorry, I will not be able to come to you this time, because the money I saved, about $300 to travel to you, I have placed it on buying a chair. But the chair costs $900, but I have got a layover, so I have to make 3 installments. Once I make 3 installments, chair will be mine. So the $300 I had saved to come to you, sorry, I put it on the chair, so I can't see you. Next time there was a chance to come, he wrote to me, "I'm sorry that the $300 I saved again to come to you, I had to put a 2nd installment on the chair, so I'm sorry I missed you." Before he could make the 3rd installment, he died. He neither saw me nor the chair. Now, for one chair, he has to come back. Because he's so much feeling in the inner self. Oh, I didn't get the chair, I couldn't go there. I made a sacrifice for the chair. He made a sacrifice of not coming to see me for the chair. Chair took precedence. Therefore, the chair will bring him back. You'll be surprised. This is the way we all come back again and again. Our attachments, and not only attachments, our desires, which increase our attachments. Every time we see something new and we desire more, it creates a new attachment. So the attachments are responsible for our coming again and again. And where are the attachments held? In the mind. And the mind is the same, body after body, not only this body, in the inner body. Can we also go to find the mind? Not the inner body. Body is only sense perceptions. Can we cross that and see what our mind looks like? What is the mind actually? What this thinking machine we are constantly using, what does it look like? Yes, we can. The method, same method. Go within the inner body. The mind is inside the inner body. Just like the inner body is inside this body. It's all a question of going within. Now, if you meditate at the 3rd eye center of the inner body, you will withdraw your attention with practice. Now, that's a much deeper meditation. But you can withdraw your attention from the sense perceptions also. And a very strange experience happens. Some of you might have done it. A very strange experience happens that you find perception. To perceive, experience, you do not need sense perceptions at all. All you need is the mind. You will discover that even the sense perceptions you use, for example, I want to see these flowers. I am using eyes here. The flowers come up into the eyes. Eyes can never see flowers. They can see color and form. How am I seeing flowers? What makes the color and the shape into flower is the mind, not the senses, not the sense perception, not the inner self. Every experience we are having is being interpreted to us in the way we are seeing from the mind. The mind is seeing what we are thinking, we are seeing with eyes. We are giving names to things, we are creating identities of things, all because of our mind. When you reach the mind per se, only with the mind, you discover all perception is possible. You don't have to break into sense perceptions at all. That's a big discovery. So when you reach your mind, by going, putting your attention within the inner self, at which point? Behind the eyes of the inner self. Exactly the same way. You discover that you are nothing but a living mind. All you have is a soul, life, and a mind. And that is yourself. Most amazing thing is you do not lose the fact it is the same self that was in the body here. Same self is in the mind. Self has not changed, form has changed. What is the shape of the mind? It does not have sense perceptions. Therefore, it does not need eyes like we see. It does not need a body like this. It does not have a body like this. But it has a presence that, like you are present in space and time, that you have a shape, but not of this body. Inner self is like this body. Mind is a different shape altogether. But the self in the mind is conscious self with all the memories. The memory becomes so sharp, you can remember millions of years of life. So amazing. Memory is a very key. If you will notice that the memory, to be able to remember, is a secret of our knowledge of time itself. How are we experiencing time? We all feel, yeah, we look at our watches, yeah, we went hour ago, we went lunch here, this is the time. How are we experiencing time? Supposing there was no memory, there'd be no time at all. It's the memory that is creating us. Yes, we went there, yes, we did this, therefore it's time. Imagine what a wrong assumption we have that there are three natures of time. Past, present and future. We always think of time as what has already gone, past. What we are living in is present. What is still to come is future. Have we ever noticed that the time we live in is called now? And now has no time at all? The moment it starts saying now, it becomes past. Before I said it was future. So there is no present at all. What we call now or present is merely a meeting point. Zero time meeting point. Then how do we feel there is time in the present? We are calling the last few seconds of our memory as present. I remember I sat here. I remember I'm just speaking to you. The word I'm just speaking is present. We are calling an immediate past into present. Therefore, what we think is past because of memory. What we think is present because of memory, short memory. Well, maybe there may be a future from where all the events are coming in. Not true. I've often said, if we did not have the capacity to hope, did not have the capacity to fear, did not have the capacity to anticipate something, if we did not have the mind that can do these three things, there will be no future. Future has been created by these functions of the mind. And since each of these functions takes time, they're all happening in the past through memory. If you study carefully the nature of our experience of time, it's all memory. Whether you call it past, present or future, it's all memory. When do you find the importance of memory? You find it when you go beyond your sensory system, beyond this body, into the realm of your own body called your mind. There you discover that what we call life here is merely a package of memory put together there. When we say we make a destiny of ourselves, a destiny is nothing but a capsule of memory placed inside us. We are just living through it, remembering it, and feeling it's a life we are leading here. You understand the real nature of life at that point. Everything that you have ever experienced is being generated there. That is why the mind has often been called a causal body. They think mind is not something in a new kind of machine functioning inside. It's our own body, a third body. Maybe fourth. If a dream body is separate, living physical body is separate, astral body is separate, causal body is the mind. And therefore, people have with great deep meditation discovered the nature of mind, discovered the nature of creation, discovered the nature of destiny, how destinies are made. I could give you a long talk on the whole system that's operating, which we call law of karma and memories and how lives are made up. But you can find it yourself just by going there. Have we then found ourselves by discovering our mind? Not really. Even mind has a life. Even mind is born and mind also dies. It's a grand dissolution that takes place when the mind dies, everything dies with it. Karma dies with it, everything dies with it. Karma, what we call karma, what is karma? Karma is merely a recollection from the past. If you have done something which you recall was good, you are rewarded. If what you did was bad, you are punished. And who determines what is good, what is bad? Your mind. And how does the mind function? Based upon the moral code in which it is growing up and the time in which it is growing up. We have these destinies placed in this physical world, and where we are born, we don't decide. Karma decide who will be our parents. Karma decide what they will teach us about good and bad, what the moral they will teach us. Society teaches where the parents are located. Religion will teach us. All these external factors which are part of life, they determine a code of good and bad, and that determines the whole law of karma of good and bad. It's just action and reaction. But they're all based on memory placed on the mind. Karma is carried by the mind. Karma is created in the mind. Karma is paid off in the mind. We sometimes think karma, the word karma is supposed to be action. That the actions create karma. Not really. You can accidentally hit somebody. Are you creating a karma? Of course not. Intention creates karma. But intention can create karma even if there is no action. So that is why we create so much karma, we are ready for coming here again and again for a long time. We accumulate so much karma because its karma is not action, it's intention. And we are intending to do so many things. Sometimes I wish I could kill him. Wow, you don't kill him. But the very intention creates a karma. Where is it held? Same mind. And plays out on the same mind in a future life. Karma can be created only when the intention is there as a deliberate intention, not even intention. Not unintentional intention. It should be deliberate intention. That means you should have time to think. Very often, should I do it or not? When that question comes, and you decide, I will do it, karma is created. The deliberation is necessary for creating a karma. That is why most of the actions we go through in life are not created karma. They are paying off the old karma. What we are born with, the whole package of destiny or life, is merely a destiny generated from past karma. We call it pralabdha shabd, pralabdha life, pralabdha, that means a destiny already fixed. What does it consist of? It consists of where you will be born, who will be your parents, where you will die, how many accidents you will have, who you will meet all in your life, how many people you will be involved with, all part of the pralabdha destiny you are born with. And it plays out. Your life is nothing but a play out of the destiny. But when these events take place, these are all events, take place on a timeline which we have created by memory, we also go through something which is called gaps in these time events. Those gaps are the one when the mind functions, says, should I do it or not do it? How does the mind function like that? Because it does not know what has been decided in the pralabdha. It has no knowledge. It has partial memory of the past, hardly any memory of the future. It has no knowledge if the future is already there or not. This block, ignorance of the future, generates a strange experience in us, which we call free will, the feeling we decide what we have to do. This free will is merely a feeling, merely an experience, because what is in pralabdha is already there for the future. We feel we can handle what we are going to do now. But when we handle it, it's according to a script already written in our destiny we made in the mind. So that is why this destiny that we make, the problems, in between we create a new karma by our intention in these gaps. We call it karemaan karma, or new action, new intentions creating another destiny for us for the future. We can pay off that old load also in this very life or future lives. But so many intentions we don't carry out, but they still create karma. In one life you can never cover the number of intentions we carry in one life. Do you know the karma we create by intention in a life is so many, we can create several hundred lives of human time, of 100 years. These are very small lives. We can create several astral lives with one life of human karma. So we are very experts, great experts in creating karma. But we have to pay, because it's a memory of the past cut off. We don't know why we are paying off the karma. We think somebody else is imposing on us. All our own intentions of the same self, the self occupying a body, has created this karma. This kind of experience of free will, deliberation, only takes place in one form of life, human physical life. Life can be many forms. All the trees growing outside are life. They have souls like ours. Insects crawling around, life. Birds flying, animals walking, dogs, cats, horses, camels, elephants, all same souls. Life is the same. Life is not different. Forms are different. In fact, in some of our scriptures, a list of the forms life can take are given. They say 8.4 million lives. 8.4 million forms of life exist. More than half of it, 5.6 million, in the plant kingdom only. Then according to Darwinian evolution, virtually the same pattern has been listed, how the life becomes more and more conscious, more and more aware of itself till it comes to human life. But in that list, they also include angels, gods, creators. Even the creators of universes are included in that as part of forms of life. Life is there. But life is not mind. Life is not body. Life makes the body alive. Life makes the body capable of awareness. To bring conscious awareness into a form is what life gives. And that life we call soul. Atma or soul is that which makes the mind alive, that makes the senses alive, that makes the body alive, that makes any form alive. Therefore, life is soul. By method of the meditation I'm mentioning to you, you can discover more about this body, how it functions, more about the astral body, more about the causal body, more about the mind. That's it. Nothing about the soul. No meditation exists in this world, and I've gone all around to look for it. No meditation exists that can give you a knowledge of the soul. Meditation can give you knowledge of your mind. But you begin to call the mind your soul. You begin to say, I think that is me. You start identifying that which has made you alive as a thinking machine. A thinking machine is not you, just a machine. It's just something you are covering, you are using. These are useful things given to us, a mind, senses, body. They're wonderful things to give, to use. But they don't become our own true self. The true self which says, I am using this, I am thinking, is not the mind. You are using the mind to think. You are using the body to sense. You are using the astral self to have sense perceptions. Using something doesn't make you that part of what you are using. Therefore, the soul cannot be discovered. True self has not been discovered by any kind of meditation. I have done so many kinds of meditation under so many gurus and teachers. So many yogis have taught me how to do better use of the energies in the body. No discovery of the self, of the soul. But soul can be discovered. That's what ultimately I found. It can be discovered, but not by meditation. All meditation requires effort. All meditation says, I have to meditate, and the I that you are using is not for the soul, but for the ego of the mind that separates you from everything else. When you say I and you are separating yourself. If you are saying from the I, from the soul, you wouldn't use the word I. You would think the totality of everything is coming, generating the experiences. It's an experience of everything, unity. That's a very different experience of the soul. But when you say I, it divides you. It's ego, what we call ego. Therefore, the I that is created for helping us to meditate, that I cannot take us beyond the mind. Something else can take us. That which we are experiencing here also. There is an experience we are all having once in a while where the I does not play a role, where the effort does not play a role. And that's called the experience of love. When we fall in love with anybody, there is no I saying, I am falling in love. It's the beloved pulling us. Love is a pull. I is a push. Effort is a push. Love is a pull. When love pulls, that's the only time for a little while we forget the I. The beloved takes the place of your own self. That's the power of love. Love is something that attracts you. That is why if something within ourselves can attract us beyond the mind, we can discover the soul. Now what is there which could be inside us that could pull us? The only thing I can think of that can pull us is our own self. Therefore, our self, not the mind, not the senses, not the body, our own soul should pull us. A soul beyond the mind. We don't know where the soul is. Forget about the pull of the soul. We don't know where it is. But I have a feeling that when we say, I am seeking to go back to my true home, I am seeking to get away from the drama, I have had enough of it, I think that pull is coming from there. I think the seeking does come from there. But we don't know what next to do. Seeking is there. But what happens is that the seeking sometimes leads us to another human being. And it looks like another human being seems to know us very well. Very strange experience. With some people we have that somebody seems to know us and the pull is coming from that outside person. This is not common, it's rare. Mostly we say we are trying to discover our own self, we are finding knowledge, we are finding everything, the I is there. Sometimes we feel that there is a pull coming from somebody else. Who is that person whose pull outside is almost looking like a response to the seeking inside? If we get close to that person, we find that the pull is very similar to the pull of love. We feel a strange kind of love pulling us toward that person, and we can't explain. Why is it pulling? The mind says, oh, you are making a fool of yourself. This is not something to worry about. It's nothing to do with your own searching and seeking. The mind creates all kinds of doubt. Pull still keeps going. I often tell the example that the poll that came to me was from this gentleman whose picture you see with the white beard, Baba Sawan Singh. Very strange experience with him all the time. I couldn't believe, what is the experience I'm having? Why am I feeling a certain strange way when I'm with him? A professor came to one of his discourses and he said, "Master, you are misleading people. You are telling them there are inner regions. You are telling them this is not our true home, the inner home inside somewhere. You talk of some such khand, some real true home. All that is nonsense. There is no evidence for that. The only evidence we have is, scientific evidence is that this life is the only life, this world is the only reality. You are trying to mislead people and try to make them all kinds of strange meditations. They don't work. I've come to tell you, please don't deceive these people." Great Master Baba Sawan Singh told him, "Professor Sahib, I'm very happy that you have expressed your opinion very honestly based on your experience. My experience is different. I share my experience with people based on what I have seen, which is different from what you are saying. We have a right to disagree on our experiences, but I appreciate your good, honest word." Professor went away. Next Sunday, he was back again to tell the same thing. He says, "Master, I've come to tell you, there is no physical evidence at all. Scientific evidence does not show anything like soul exists. It's all the physical body is the only real thing. And this world is the only reality. You are misleading people. Please don't do that. They are poor people. And they are coming to you being misled by your lectures." Great Master gave the same reply to him. "Professor sir, my experience is different than yours. Therefore, I appreciate you came and told me this, your honest opinion." Third Sunday, Professor was back again. Then Great Master said, "Professor Saab, you came last 2 weeks also to say the same thing, and now you come again to say the same thing." He said, "I don't know," Professor said. "I somehow feel I like to come and see you again and again." Mind saying something totally opposite. What they say, heart or soul saying something totally different. Therefore, what is pulling? Now, what is there in a human being to pull us when we want to be pulled inside our own self? Truth is inside, we are looking at outside at another human being. How can that be? How does it work? Simply because we do not know that we can pull ourselves from inside. A human being is appearing who we call a perfect living master. Not master, not guru. Sant, Satguru. Sant, Satguru. Real guru. True guru. What is the nature of a true guru? What is a human being whom I am calling him a true guru? What the definition of a true guru is? That he is not outside, but inside. He represents our own self inside. How can he represent our own self? When he's just an ordinary person like us, he represents, because the very method that I was telling, that you can be pulled inside, somebody has pulled him to that level where he discovered the unity of all souls. We discovered in totality what we call our true home, we actually are only one source. If it is one source and he's aware of the source, then obviously he's aware of my inside as much as of his inside, if it is separate. It's not separate. Therefore, a perfect living master, whom we call a Sansat Guru, is not merely a teacher. In fact, he is not a teacher. He is the one providing a pull to us from within our own self. How do we verify this? It's a big statement to make, that there is a human being who knows exactly what's happening inside my head. How can I believe that? What is the verification of this? Now the verification comes like this. When we go to sleep, we see 100 people in a dream. We don't know all of them. They are strangers. In them we see 3 or 4 of them whom we know. When we wake up, those 100 disappear. But 3 or 4 we knew are still there. We were just remembering them in the dream. They were also there in the wakeful state. What would happen if we woke up again? From this physical state, we wake up to an astral state of experience. Here we are seeing millions of people around, and we know some of our friends. And when we wake up, we find the millions were merely created for this experience of the physical world, but a few of them are still there. Supposing we were to awake a further level of awareness, and we find that there were a lot of people we saw at different levels, but some of them are still there. And what happens every time we wake up, we find one person is always there, even to the top. Then we discover that person was ourself, because at the top there is no second. Therefore, a perfect living master whom we meet here in a physical body is not really a person like ourselves trying to do things for himself or for us. He is ourself as an experience generated by ourselves in this physical world. If we understand that the experiences we have here are generated from within, not from outside. And again we have heard this thing. In fact, Swami Vivekananda, great Swami, in his own right, when he came to USA, Chicago, he came to Chicago more than 120 years ago. And by chance, the time was when there was a World Congress of Religions going on. And he spoke there. And he said, this world is illusion. We are creating it. It does not exist by itself. By the way, yesterday some scientists also proved physics. On the quantum basis, they say there is no objective reality. Yesterday, the news came up. No objective reality. It's all subjective based on the observer. Quantum physics is bringing them close to spirituality. Now, Vivekananda says, everything is being created from inside. It's all inside. It's projected. We think sense perceptions are seeing. They are generating the experience they are seeing. They are generating the experience and exercising the perception at the same time. It's all maya, illusion, mithya. Finish. When you die, it finishes. Second day he spoke again. He said, if everything that you are seeing is unreal, illusion, then I must also be illusion. You are seeing me also. Then how come I, an illusion, is trying to tell you something when I am also unreal? He said, this unreality that you are watching here is different from the unreality you watch elsewhere. That you take as real, this you take as real, but I am telling you this is not real. Other things tell you we are real. This unreality is bringing you to reality by saying go within, not saying come out. What's the difference between a teacher and perfect living master? A teacher tells us a method to do something. A perfect living master says, go within yourself to find who? To find him. A perfect living master says, I am not outside what you are seeing. You want to see me? Go within. His whole emphasis is that you discover my reality, which you are seeing outside. I am just like yourself outside. I am born like us. I die like you. I eat food like you. I fall sick like you. I am no different as a human being. As a physical body, there is no difference at all. Difference is only in the awareness that this is a picture being drawn from within yourself. I am there. So perfect living masters help us to go within and the little experience of love we felt outside, which was not easily explained, becomes deeper inside. Every stage we go, we find they are there. That is why the difference between us, ordinary human beings, and a perfect living master is that they are operating from within ourselves as our true self, our own self. When we reach the top, we discover it our own self made the arrangement in physical body at a certain time of our experience. When we are tired of the creation to go back home, we made the arrangement ourselves to generate a person who will be like an ordinary person and pull us. It's our own arrangement for the self to pull us up. This discovery is only made by us when we reach the top. So we have ourselves made the arrangement. After all, why did we come into this world? If our own place must be a lovely place to live in, everybody says real anand, real joy, real happiness, real bliss is only available there in our true home. That's where we were living. What made it necessary for us to come into this physical world of duality and suffering and pain and pleasure? All these things are happening here, and we feel it's more painful than pleasurable simply because of the nature of time. When it's pleasurable, time flies quickly. When it's painful, time slows down. So even if we're equal, even if pleasure and pain were equal in this world, we'd feel more pain. Why did we come here? There must be some good reason for this creation to take place and for us to live in state of great bliss, to leave that state and come here. The answers to this question are very strange. First answer is, we never left our home. The whole experience is taking place there only. Because our home, our true home, is total, is complete. If it is God, it's complete. If it is truth, it's complete. If it is Satchkhand, it's complete. It's total. Whatever it is, if it's consciousness, it's total. That means there's nothing outside of it. If nothing is outside of it, then this must also be part of it. What has happened is we have not left our home at all. We never left it. We just left the awareness of it and picked up other awarenesses. It's like a dream. When we have a dream, we think we have gone somewhere. We wake up, we discover we went nowhere. The dream created a space and time where we go. Same thing is happening here. This is like a dream within a dream within a dream within a dream. That's what the real nature is of creation. And the methods of meditation we talk of are merely triggering ourselves to wakefulness. Just triggers for wakefulness to get to higher levels of awareness. And when we discover our total awareness, we discover we never left our home. We left the awareness. Why did we leave awareness even? If we were in a state of happiness and bliss, why did we leave that? To understand that, we can speculate that what is consciousness? What makes us aware and makes us conscious of the world or of ourselves? If we look at the nature of consciousness, we find that consciousness is operating in a way if it is fed with two opposite views, it appreciates one of the views better. For example, we see light here. Supposing there was no darkness, we would not even know if there is light here. But when we see darkness and see light, we appreciate light. The world of duality, the world of pairs of opposites, generates this conscious experience that you appreciate. The word is appreciation. You appreciate the positive side more if you have seen the negative side. And we have this experience all the time in this life. If you have seen something negative, then we see the positive, we appreciate it more. Is it possible that we generated a world of pairs of opposites to have an experience, a greater appreciation of our own experience of a world with no opposites at all. A non-dual world, which is our true world, is being appreciated by us by generating an experience only, not generating a real world, generating an experience of a dual world. When we look at it from that point of view, it justifies the creation of this universe as merely a means to greater appreciate our permanent true experience of a true home, where we always had the experience. We generate an awareness of duality merely to have the experience of the non-dual. That's a great rationale for saying why the world was created, why we are here. We are here for the same reason, to appreciate. There is a book by one of the well-known mystics, Kabir. Kabir writes a book called Anurag Sagar, Ocean of Love. It's a dialogue between him and a disciple of his, Dharmdas. Dharmdas asks, why were we created? And he gives in story form. He says, it cannot be described, but I'll make it like a story. So when he makes a story of creation, there in that book he says that there are souls who are still living in our true home. And then there are us who have come here, who are souls who have come into the experience of duality. And he says, those souls he calls bunts. And the souls have come here. When they return, he calls them hans. He says, when the hans who have had experience of creation, when the hans return to the true home, the bunts says, you are dancing even more than us. You are rejoicing even more than us. What is special about you? And the hans says, you don't know what you are missing. That means you do not have an experience by which you can appreciate what you already have. And we can appreciate because we have seen the opposite of it. So there he's explaining the very purpose of this creation, the whole creation. The whole creation, in all its forms, generates an appreciation for a true home. Nothing else could generate that appreciation. So that is why it's a beautiful creation in totality. If you want to enjoy life, this life, mental life, sensory life, spiritual life, life of the soul, life of totality, see the whole show. You have the capability to see the whole show right here. It's only in a human body. You have that strange experience of free will. You have experience which makes you capable of seeking. Seeking is connected with free will. If you had no free will, you would never be able to seek. To seek is the secret. To seek the truth is a sign that you are on the right track. If you seek the total, you will wake up. And the arrangement for waking up is made by you already. It will happen. A perfect living master with the totality of awareness will appear in your life. You won't find him, but he'll appear. Why can't you find him? If he's so perfect, you should be able to find him. Because there are no signs of perfection of a person's inner awareness. You can never know the awareness of anybody. Therefore, the person who will be a perfect living master in your life, for you, generated by you earlier when you left your home, that only that human being will appear at the right time when you say, I am ready, I have had enough, I want to go home. It's your own method, it's your own arrangement. And only when you are ready, supposing you say, I am still enjoying this world, no matter a little bad, good or bad, but I am still liking it, go on enjoying it. Such a person will not appear in your life. If you want simple help, say, I can't put up with my financial losses. I believe there are people who have got control over these things. You can find the gurus. You can find psychics, you can find people, they can temporarily help you. But if you feel, this is not my place, I am not wanting help in here, I want to get out back to my true home, that seeking when it comes, a perfect living master automatically will appear in your life by coincidence. He will wear no particular sign on his that I am a perfect living master. In fact, for certain I can tell you, he will never say he is a master. Why would he? He has not come to say something to establish here. He has come as a private arrangement on our call to appear and with that strange experience of love to pull us and bring us within our own self, not outside. What is strange about that love? If we associate that person more, what do we find? We find that that love is totally unconditional and non-judgmental. Such a person, when he comes into our life, he'll never judge how good or bad we are. He's not come in response to our karma. He's not come to look at our karma. He's come in response to the call of the soul to go back to its true home. His only interest is in the seeking that we are having inside. In fact, when he looks at our karma, he feels compassion. Look how terribly trapped they are in this very big maze of karma created around, which makes them perpetuate their living here. Such a person comes to pull us out of this. He does not have to wear any particular kind of garments, either saffron colored or white colored or black colored or no saffron or no. He doesn't have to do any of these things. He has to come just like a friend with unconditional love. The more we associate, we define, there is no judgment in that. It's always love. If we show any love for that person, he loves us. If we show hatred for that person, he loves us. If we kill that person, he loves us. That's the kind of love from such a person whom I call a perfect living master. So perfect living master comes only for love, knowing love is the pull. But love is not the only pull. There's something else also in us that pulls. Something that tells us, gives us answers, but we don't want to listen to that. It's called gut feeling, intuition. Intuition, sudden feeling. This is not going to be right. This will happen. My mind has said, I have prepared my tickets to travel tomorrow. Something is telling me, don't go. Why? Everything is normal. Where is it coming from? My mind is saying, everything is okay. Don't go by this sudden feeling in you. And you say, no, something is telling me, I must cancel my trip. An intuitive feeling telling me, gut feeling telling me, something telling me inside, don't go, I'm not going. Next day I find an accident of the plane I was going. My gut feeling was right, my brain was wrong, my thinking was wrong. The mind operates only through thinking. And thinking is based upon the data you have in front of you. But the intuition is coming from the soul. Intuition is coming from your real self. Not only love comes from there, intuition comes from there. Appreciation of beauty comes from there. Many feelings we have, they come from there, from the soul. They're divided. In our consciousness, in our head, there are two types of functions going on. Mental and spiritual. Mental functions are all connected with thinking and all take time. Even the smallest thought takes time. The spiritual functions are all non-time, instantaneous. Intuition, instantaneous. Love, instantaneous. Appreciation of beauty, instantaneous. All these are instantaneous experiences with no time lag. Big difference between the two. Mind generates time and space to operate, whereas soul does not need it. We have a spiritual will and a mental will both operating inside us. People say, how can we tell us a quick formula? They ask me. to improve our life here. And if there's another life, we'll also improve there. But let's try here. I say, quickest formula, develop your spiritual will. Your intuition will grow. So coincidences that help you what to do will grow. Your life will change. How do you develop spiritual will? When the mind says, do it, and something is saying no. Mind says, do it, something is saying no. Where is the no coming from? It has to be other than the mind. Because mind is saying, do it. Something is saying no. You are saying no. The soul is saying no. Then why not develop the power to say no? I have suggested to my friends, learn to say no when the mind wants something the most. Not every day, not all the time. Only 2-3 times a week. 2-3 times a week, learn to say no to the mind. Your spiritual will increase. When it increases, you will find your life becomes spiritual. This life, physical life, becomes spiritual. Mind cannot deceive you. You will have the ability to say no. When the spiritual will grows in us. Now, sometimes they call spiritual will, divine will, God's will. Some people say, live in God's will. What does it mean to live in God's will? To live in God's will means to live in the spiritual will, which is not mind's will. Any will that's coming in other than the mental will, your mind's will, is God's will. Rumi, Jalaluddin Rumi, in one of his masnavis, takes up this case. He says, people ask me, live in the will of Allah, live in the will of God. And they say, isn't everything happening according to His will? How can we distinguish everything that happens is God's will? Then how are you saying live in God's will? Everything is God's will. He says, no. When you use your thinking machine, it's mind's will. When you are not, it's God's will. And then he says, how to know God's will? He says, if He has given you a plow in your hand, dig, that's His will. He's given a pen in your hand, write, that's His will. If He has created circumstances for you to do certain things, to do your duties according to the circumstances, He has expressed His will. Even some of the old Indian systems of teaching how to live a divine life distinguished between karma and dharma. What was it? Karma laid down the conditions of your circumstances. Old karma brings those conditions. How to handle them? How to handle them with the duties to perform for dharma? So dharma was a duty to cope up with the karma coming from the past. If we do everything as if it is duty created by circumstances, we are living in the spiritual will, the divine will. Just following these little tips can change our life right here. I am sharing these things with you just because I feel you are all on spiritual path. You are all moving in the same direction. You all want to know better about your own self. You all want to have a spiritual life. You are all tired, according to my judgment, of this world and the tactics of the mind, what it's playing. Therefore, I am just sharing with you some of these things that I experienced by virtue of being just a disciple of a perfect living master. Everything I've shared with you is experiential, not from books, and not untested. So that is why I always believed when he said, experience, no scope or true spiritual path for blind faith. Don't have faith just because somebody said it. Have faith what you experienced. Generate more experience. Supposing you have a limited experience, then believe what you experienced. But don't rule out that just because you haven't experienced something, it doesn't exist. People have more experiences, and be prepared to have more experience yourself. But the faith should be based upon your experience, and that faith will grow. We call it living faith. Like all living things, faith grows. Every day experience happens. Some experiences happen in meditation internally. And many experiences happen outside. They are also happening because of what is happening internally. Outside things change. And you are able to notice. Some things you notice that these could not have happened by the normal law of probability by which things happen here. And you sometimes, this is a miracle happening. Miracles start happening. More meditation, discovery of inner self, more miracles happen outside. So that is why the teachings of the great master, who was a perfect living master, is to develop your spiritual self and carry out your duties. Everything that you have to do outside is a duty cast upon you. Do it as a duty. Don't try to make things your own. Use them. Consider everything has been given to us by the Creator for use, not to make our own. Don't always try to say, this is mine. Say, it's mine for use. If you do these simple things, your life will change. Much for the better. People are all looking for happiness, and you see how much happiness can come merely by a few changes in life. Little meditation to know more of yourself. Little change in attitude outside, not trying to be possessive of things, not trying to make them your own, just using them very well, life changes. Thank you very much for very patiently listening to me today. There are some people who have asked for time to see me. Time is very limited. It was only one day program. Therefore, those I have been meeting again and again will have chance elsewhere to see me again and again. But some of you have never seen me before. I will certainly see those who have never seen me before. Thank you very much.